Is that too loud or? Okay. So I'm going to talk about some of my obsessions. You've already heard. I'm obsessed, a bit obsessed with open science. Not going to talk about that at all. I'm a bit obsessed with social media and science. Not going to talk about that really at all. Randy didn't mention this. This is a bigger obsession, more of a lifelong thing. Apologies to any non-Red Sox fans out there. Not going to talk about that. But what I am going to talk about is microbes and microbial evolution. And amazingly, I did not realize this, but I have been a bit obsessed about this for a long time. So this, in ninth grade English class, we got an assignment where you could write your own essay question and then answer it. First of all, ignore the handwriting. That really is mine, but I am embarrassed about it. And my essay question was, describe one step in the evolution of a bacteria. And then I answered it in 3 or 4 pages. I don't remember this at all. And I went to college to be an East Asian Studies major and eventually switched to biology. And as I was telling Jennifer earlier, one of the reasons I switched to studies in molecular evolution was I took a class as a sophomore from a graduate student, Jennifer, on molecular evolution that just changed my life and got me really interested in combining ecological and evolutionary studies with molecular biology. So that's what I'm going to talk a little bit about here, my obsession with microbes and microbial evolution. So in this context, you know, I've done a lot of work on microbes and microbial evolution, but this day and age, we talk about this in terms of the microbiome. That's sort of the hottest word, hottest topic in microbial studies. And there's been, this is a plot of PubMed, you know, hits to the word microbiome, and it keeps going up almost exponentially over time. There's just an incredible rise in studies of microbial communities. I'll talk about what the microbiome is in a few minutes. There's been this big effort to characterize the microbes on human. There's a European effort, an NIH effort, a variety of other efforts on the human microbiome. There are microbes and microbiomes in the news all the time, in good and bad ways, and now there's a lot of discussion of how we may either help or hurt our microbiome in a variety of ways. So it's become this incredibly hot topic. If you're interested in what it means, I've actually written a couple of blog posts and articles about this. Basically, the way I view the microbiome is the collection of microbes that live in a particular ecosystem or biome, the total content of that microbial community. Sometimes people use this specifically to refer to the genomes of those organisms. I usually use it to refer to just the collection of organisms in a system. Microbiome studies have gotten the most interest from studies of the cloud of microbes that live in and on people, but as, of course, many of you know, here, there's a cloud of microbes that live in just about every ecosystem on the planet or every place on the planet. Many of these are associated with plant and animal hosts, and those do some very interesting things. But there are also microbial communities in the soil, in the water, in the air, and every other place on the planet. And of course, Novozymes has specialized in making use of some of these microbes for a variety of systems. But there's microbes everywhere. In general, now people are using this term microbiome to refer to any community of microbes. So one question that I'm sort of really interested in is, why has this become such a hot topic now? What has gotten people so interested in microbiomes most recently? And I'm just going to, as an introduction, go through what I think are some of the explanations. One of them is this growing appreciation of microbial diversity. So there have been, over the last 30 or 40 years, an increasing number of studies of microbes in various systems shown to be important in the health and function of a particular ecosystem. You know, of course, this started with the discovery of microbes, but there's an incredible diversity of form that has been characterized in microbes, and a growing appreciation of this diversity of form. There's an incredible diversity of phylogeny, that is the different types of microbes scattered across the evolutionary tree. And of most interest to people is contained within microbes is an incredible amount of functional diversity. Chemical diversity in particular is what a lot of people have been interested in. And of course, we microbiologists think that microbes run the planet. To study. Another reason that I think the microbiome has grown in interest is what I call the post-genome move. So as you heard, I worked at Tiger for 8 years sequencing genomes, indirectly associated with some projects on some of the larger organisms, but mostly worked on microorganisms. And during that time, there was a lot of selling of the benefits that would come from sequencing the human genome, or sequencing a plant genome, or sequencing a microbial genome. And let's just say some of those benefits did not come into being immediately. So there's been lots of articles written about this. Did we oversell the benefits of the human genome? And of course, there are reasons why the genome might not explain everything. There's, of course, the gene content only explains what the potential is. Now we have to characterize the transcriptome, and the proteome, and the metabolome to understand what's actually encoded from the genome. There's epigenetic tags on organisms where the individual genome sequence is not the only thing that tells you what's going on in the organism. There's something called the variome, which is the variation within individual multicellular organisms. There are different genetic content in different parts of an organism. And the microbiome is just sort of, in this context, yet another thing that it can explain basically why the genome itself does not explain everything. Another reason for the increased attention to microbiomes is technological advances. And you know about all these in terms of a variety of studies of biology, but for microbes, this has been particularly important for a variety of reasons. And one of the main reasons is that, as I assume most of the people at Novozymes know, if you go to any community in the environment, like this Yellowstone hot spring, and you collect a sample and you split it in two and you look at the sample in a microscope, and you count the number of microorganisms that you can see there, or you take out a sample and you grow it in the laboratory and you count how many different things you can grow, what you see is that there's a much greater number of things that you can see in the microscope than things that you can grow in the laboratory in pure culture. And this is generally known as the great plate count anomaly, or a variety of other acronyms, and it's been a big problem in microbial studies. There are many ways that people have tried to deal with this, but in the 1980s, primarily, Norm Pace and colleagues developed an alternative way to study microbes and their communities by going out into the environment and isolating originally RNA from the environment and now DNA from the environment, sequencing the DNA from those environmental samples and using analysis of the DNA to indirectly characterize what microbes were present in that environmental sample. A lot of this work was based upon the work that had been done by Carl Woese, where he had taken cultured organisms and shown that you could characterize what kind of cultured organism you were looking at by sequencing ribosomal RNA genes from those organisms. So isolate ribosomal RNA originally, and now the DNA that encodes ribosomal RNA, sequence it, line up sequences from different organisms, compare them to each other in much the same way that you compare the skeletons of vertebrates, look at the similarities and differences, quantify those similarities and differences, and then build an evolutionary tree that tells you what kind of organism you're looking at compared to other organisms that have been characterized. This is what led Carl Woese to discover the third branch in the tree of life, the archaea. And this general concept is basically what Norm Pace and colleagues took and applied to environmental samples and used it to indirectly characterize organisms by sequencing their ribosomal RNA genes and then placing them in the context of known taxa by phylogeny. That's something generally known as phylotyping, which I will come back to. What I'm sort of generally referring to as CSI microbiology can be applied to a variety of microbial communities and has. One thing that people are doing now, which I will come back to, is rather than just sequencing ribosomal RNA genes from environmental samples, we can now sequence the entire genomic content from an environmental sample, something generally known as metagenomics. Apply the same general methods to those metagenomic samples with a little bit of variation that I'll talk about in a while. You can figure out what organisms are in those samples by building evolutionary trees of sequences from those samples. You can also, very importantly, make predictions of the functions of the organisms in those samples by running the same tools that people had developed to characterize the genomes of individual isolates in the laboratory. You can predict differences between communities and try and infer what are the likely explanations for those differences as well. Just as an aside, if you've seen a bit of the press recently, there's a bunch of new papers arguing that archaea may not be the third branch in the tree of life, that they may in fact be a subgroup. Sorry, I drew this backwards, that eukaryotes may be a subgroup of archaea. I'm not going to really talk about that in detail, but what that has come from has been analyzing genes other than ribosomal RNA genes contained within genomes of organisms. And it doesn't always give you exactly the same picture as ribosomal RNA, although the picture is frequently very similar. So Why have microbiomes gone really crazy? That's because sequencing has gotten cheap and easy and efficient. And as the costs and difficulty of sequencing have gone down, people have applied this to all sorts of organisms. But in particular, microbes have been revolutionized because, again, we can't grow many of them in the environment, and we can use the DNA sequencing to characterize their diversity in a variety of ways. Go back one slide here. So the last reason that I think the microbiome field has gone sort of crazy has been studies of a few microbiomes in particular have shown that they carry very important functions that were probably unappreciated in the past. And in particular, these are the clouds of microbes that live in and on plants and animals. So the probably most important study from this was done in Jeff Gordon's lab by Peter Turnbaugh and a few others, where they showed that if you take microbes from a genetically defective mouse that is obese with defects in the OB gene, those mice have different microbes in their gut. Not that surprising, wouldn't have to have anything directly to do with the obesity, but they have different metabolism. They took those microbes, transplanted them into germ-free wild-type mice, and they got fat. And so this blew people's minds, basically, and led to an enormous increase in the attention paid to microbial communities, because it wasn't just that they could differ between different health states, they could transmit health states to individuals, at least in this mouse system. So in this context is where we are in microbiome studies basically now, and what we do in my lab is try and characterize various microbial communities. And this is what I'm going to sort of go through in my talk, is the challenges and opportunities in this area. So there are many challenges associated with characterizing entire communities of microorganisms. One of this relates to the diversity of microbes. They're estimated now to be thousands of different major lineages or phyla of bacteria and archaea. We understand the functions and the diversity of maybe 10 of those. The amount of microbial diversity that is out there in terms of total evolutionary diversity is enormous. There's even diversity within species that is sort of very different than what we see within plants and animals. So two E. coli strains can differ by 40% of their genome content. So we have all this evolutionary diversity, and then even within species, we can have massive differences within the genetic diversity. And that leads to differences within functional diversity, both within and between species and across the tree of life. Another issue of the complexity is that the way we're characterizing communities right now is mostly go to an environment, swab a sample, collect some fecal material, collect some soil, grind it up, and run short-read DNA sequencing technology on that sample and try and infer what's going on in the community of organisms from thousands to hundreds of thousands to now billions of sequence reads. And that's very challenging to interpret that data. And there's also, of course, as I mentioned before, lots of variation within hosts that's both due to the microbes and due to other features like the variation in transcription, the variation in epigenetics, the variation in the environment that individuals see, the variation in the genome content, and so on. So in this context, we're trying to understand the structure and function of microbial communities, especially those that live in and on plants and animals, and it's just a very complicated issue to try and tease apart. A second aspect of this complication that I think is really important to think about, it relates to public understanding. And this is a big challenge in the area of science in general, but microbiome studies, I think, may be exacerbated in some ways related to this. On the one hand, we have lots of people, probably many in this room, that are what you could call germaphobes. That is, they think about microbes in the context of they're going to make you sick, and most of the time they think about how we can filter out, swab, sterilize, kill, destroy, or get rid of the microbes from a particular environment. You know, you have a cold, you go in and take antibiotics, no matter what the cause of it is, we put antimicrobials in our shoes, in our clothing, on our kitchen counters, in our filters, in our cars, all throughout the planet, we're basically slaughtering microbial diversity. There's antimicrobial compounds in toothpastes, in shampoos, in just about everything that we see in the cosmetic world, and it's probably a really stupid idea. But people are afraid of microbes, so that's what happens. On the other hand, we also have this kind of psychotic other side of things, where some people are promoting microbes and the microbiomes as though they're going to save the planet in every which way but lose. So every possible human ailment has now been ascribed to being caused by problems in the microbial community in the gut, even if there is absolutely no evidence for this. There are clinics throughout the country that offer fecal transplantation for schizophrenia. Fecal transplant. It's not actually, that's probably not the worst example. The hype has gone way beyond the science in this area. There's probiotics advertised that apply to different groups. So at the local CVS drugstore, there's a whole shelf of probiotics for kids, for the elderly, for men, for women, for dogs, for cats, for every other possible group, there's probiotics. There's a book out every week now on the microbiome and how it's going to save your life. There's all sorts of weird stuff out there in the blogging world. And I give out an overselling the microbiome award on my blog, and I literally cannot keep up with the number of examples of this.